Let's open our Bibles to Matthew chapter 8, and we've finished the teaching and the Sermon on the Mount, so we're going to get back into the narrative, the account of the life of Jesus, which when you think of all of the things that he did, it's actually very brief, the amount of information that's given to us about his ministry. We're going to look at this first miracle that following this, the teaching of the Sermon on the Mount that then Matthew records for us. It's in chapter 8, verses 1 through 4. It says, when he, that's Jesus, when he had come down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him. Behold, a leper came and worshipped him, saying, Lord, if you're willing, you can make me clean. And then Jesus put out his hand and touched him, saying, I'm willing, be cleansed. Immediately his leprosy was cleansed. And Jesus said to him, see that you tell no one, but go your way, show yourself to the priests, and offer the gift that Moses commanded as a testimony to them. Lord, we thank you for your ministry to people who are in need of cleansing. We thank you, Lord, that you came to rescue those who would not be able to rescue themselves. We thank you that you came to bring healing to those who would not find healing any other way. We thank you, Lord, that you're a Savior, a Redeemer, and that you're able to save them to the uttermost who draw near to God by you, that you're the way and the truth and the life, and that we do come to the Father by you. And we bless you for that, Lord. We thank you for your continuing ministry to us, and we pray that you'd stir up our hearts, Lord, of what is available to us to continually come boldly to your throne of grace to find the help and the grace that we need in our time of need. And also, Lord, that we would enter into your ministry to the lost and to the lonely, to the unlovable, to the unclean, and realizing that you were not unwilling to touch the leper, and you were more than willing to cleanse, and that you came for that very purpose. So speak to us, Lord, about what you want to do for us, but then also how we can join with you in what you're doing in this world. We want to be with you, Jesus. We want to be doing what you're doing. Doing it with you, Lord. So help us and encourage us, we ask in your name. Amen. We spent so much time making our way through the Sermon on the Mount that I want to kind of go back and look at chapter 4 to kind of put it in the context. Matthew has a few sections of his account of the life of Jesus that are extended teaching records. So we want to keep track of what's happening. Chapter 3, remember, Jesus was baptized, and then immediately after he was baptized, chapter 4, he was led out into the wilderness where he was tempted by the devil. This was the beginning of his ministry. His ministry began in identifying with his people in baptism. Remember, John the Baptist said, you should be baptizing me, and you want me to baptize you? And Jesus said, permit it, it fulfills all righteousness. So there's no reason for Jesus to be baptized by John the Baptist because John the Baptist's baptism was not a Christian baptism. It wasn't the baptism that we undergo. But remember, it was called a baptism of repentance. People were confessing their sins. So if Jesus comes out into the water to be baptized for repentance, what's Jesus going to repent of? He doesn't need to be baptized, right? But he said it will fulfill all righteousness. Jesus was, in his life, entering into identification with lost humanity, with his own people, Israel first, to the Jew first, but then as Paul the Apostle puts it, to the Jew first, but also to the Greek, to the whole world, to the Jew first and to the Greek. And so he underwent baptism and then immediately from there was led out by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil, which of course he overcame the devil. And then chapter 4, verse 12, when Jesus had heard that John had been put into prison, he departed to Galilee. So his ministry was not going to primarily take place in the more populated area around Jerusalem, the area of Judea. He was going to move to the north, to Galilee. That's where he was raised, in Nazareth. But even Nazareth wasn't going to be his base. Verse 13 says, leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum, which is by the sea, in the regions of Zebulun and Naphtali. Zebulun and Naphtali were two geographic regions that were noted by the names Zebulun and Naphtali. They were two of the 12 sons of Jacob, or Israel. So we call them the 12 tribes of Israel. So each one of those tribes had an allotment of land. And so Zebulun and Naphtali were in the north. That would be around the Galilee. So there was a prophecy that was fulfilled in Jesus moving to that area around the Sea of Galilee to do his ministry. Verse 15, Isaiah had said, "The land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea, beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles." And then this wonderful statement in verse 16, "The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light, and upon those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has dawned." And from that time, Jesus began to preach and to say, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." So right there around the sea, the majority of his ministry that we're familiar with takes place in these little villages that are on the northwest part of the Sea of Galilee. If you just look at the Sea of Galilee on your map and just go straight north, and you just, if you took the northernmost part, right in the middle of the north, and then just went west, kind of from noon to like 10 o'clock on a clock. And that little piece of area right there is where the vast majority of all of his ministry took place. And when you go, if you ever get a chance to go to Israel and see the Sea of Galilee, you're going to not call it the Sea of Galilee, but the small lake of Galilee. It's not a big area. It's not a gigantic. I mean, it's a big enough lake, but it's not gigantic. And these little villages and this one little part is where Jesus did most of his ministry. He called the fishermen, and that's the bulk of his ministry. A big focus of Matthew's telling of the story of the life of Jesus is going to focus on Jesus and his commitment and his discipleship of these men that he chose to be with him. His method of ministry was ministering to the large groups, yes, but primarily the bulk of his energy, you would say, or the majority of his time was spent with a small group of people that he was discipling. So he calls these fishermen to follow him. And then the summary of this whole season of ministry, which we're going to look at a specific example of this, is verses 23 through 25 of chapter 4. "Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, healing all kinds of sickness and all kinds of disease among the people." That's a summary of this early part of his ministry. He was very popular. Thousands of people began to follow him. It was a ministry of teaching and preaching and healing. And then verse 24, his fame went throughout all of Syria, even to the east. And they brought to him all kinds of sick people who were afflicted with various diseases and torments, those who were demon-possessed, epileptics, paralytics, and he healed them. Great multitudes followed him from Galilee and from Decapolis and Jerusalem and Judea. So guys from the south had come up to the north and even beyond the Jordan, on the other side of the Jordan. So then chapter 5, seeing the multitude, he went up on the mountain, and then we have the Sermon on the Mount. So even though it took us several weeks to go through the Sermon on the Mount, it probably only took Jesus an afternoon. He didn't spend weeks and weeks analyzing what he was saying. He just shared the word. So in the middle of this ministry, here's an example of his teaching. So it said he was teaching in the synagogues, and so when these massive groups started following, they couldn't fit into a synagogue. And so just out on the hillside where thousands of people could sit in a natural amphitheater where his voice could project and people could all hear him, and they all came and sat and Jesus taught. So this is an example of what he was teaching, the Sermon on the Mount. Then when it finished, if you look at the end of chapter 7, "So it was when Jesus had ended these sayings, the people were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes." Jesus' ministry was a ministry of the Word of God, and whenever anybody shares the Word of God, it's always with authority. That's one of the exciting things about having a Bible and memorizing it, learning it so that you can share it with people, is you yourself don't have to change your personality. You don't have to get a thunderous voice or have a powerful personality. You can share the Word of God. You don't have to tell people that it's chapter and verse, or Maybe the sentence popped into your head and you're talking to somebody and a Bible verse popped in your head. You don't even remember where it is. You're pretty sure it's in the Bible because you remember it from being from the Bible. And then you share it with a person. It is powerful on its own. You share the word of God, people will hear it, and it will be powerful. It will have authority. The word of God will speak into someone's life, and it will speak in a way as there's not an option, you know? It's just not take it or leave it, but this is the truth. And it's like a sword. It's like a sharp two-edged sword that cuts, and it divides. And when it comes out, it never comes back empty without accomplishing the purpose for which God sent it. So you want to know the word of God. You want to let it come into your life and have authority in your life, but you also want that to happen so then you can also share it. So even though we read this and we associate it with Jesus, of course, no man ever spoke like he spoke, but we have his words. So we don't have to be Jesus, but we can share the word of Jesus. He said, the words that I speak, they're spirit and they're life. So if we're sharing what Jesus has said, not just the red letters in the Gospels, but anything from his word that Jesus has given to us, and we share it with people, and it's what it means in its context, it's going to have power. It's going to have authority. So here's the teaching ministry of Jesus. Here's that summary statement, and then here's an example of his teaching. And then now we're going to get into chapter 8. We're going to have kind of an example of some specific healings that were taking place in and around the Galilee. And the first one, the first specific one that Matthew wants us to know about was the cleansing of a leper. He came down from the mountain, great multitudes were around, it's a general statement, and Matthew groups these together. He's not really necessarily concerned the chronology of these things. These are just samples of the ministry of Jesus, the healing ministry of Jesus. And what was remarkable, verse 2, was a leper. A leper. Now, leprosy had great significance to the Jewish people. It was something that was a sign in their history of sin. There were actually people that when they were sinning, leprosy broke out in them physically so that everybody would know the secret sin that was on the inside. They would see it visibly. A very important person in Israel's history, Moses' own sister, Miriam, became a leper. Remember, she saw her brother being used, and like all good big sisters, knew that if that little punk could be used, then surely, you know, and I'm just saying that because I notice a few big sisters in the room. You know, big sisters are, they know who's in charge. They're the director of all the plays. They're the ones that keep all the other kids in line. And so here's Miriam. Remember when Moses went out in the little boat, who was watching him to make sure that he went where he was supposed to go? It was Miriam. So later on now, Moses is raised up by God to lead the people, and Miriam begins to just crave this position of prominence. And what happened to her? She starts to speak out. Well, I don't know why I'm not the, you know, and what happens? God struck her with leprosy. So if you say leprosy in a Jewish context or a biblical, we say the Old Testament, but for the Jewish person in the first century, leprosy has a connotation if you think of Miriam. There's not just Miriam, though. Remember, Elisha had a servant named Gehazi who wanted the money when the army commander, you know, came and came down to be healed of his leprosy, Naaman the Syrian, and he was healed. And Elisha said, "Don't worry about it," you know. And the guy said, "Well, I've got a bunch of stuff I could give you," you know, and. You know, you're a religious leader, you know, you must want something small for your friend, you know. And he said, no, you know, this is just from the Lord. And so the guys took off and Gehazi snuck out of there and said, actually, you know, ran the guys down after they got around the corner and said, you know, maybe, do you have anything, you know, something? Kind of changed our mind. And so he got something, and not only did he get the something, but he got something else that he didn't want. And remember what Elisha said? The leprosy that was on that guy is now going to be on you. And Gehazi became a leper. So you got Miriam, leprosy, it's a sign of her sin. Gehazi, leprosy, a sign of his sin. But there's more. I feel like an infomercial, a leprosy infomercial. But there's more. There's also Uzziah, King Uzziah, who wants to have a place of prominence also, much like Miriam. He decides he's a big shot now. He's been king for a long time. He's been a good king. You know, the priests and the kings were separate. They're from two different family lines in the nation. I guess God wanted a separation also of powers until Jesus is the king and the priest. But, the priests are from the tribe of Levi, descended through Aaron. And the kings are from the tribe of Judah, and they're descended through David. And so here are these two different lines. Well, Uzziah wants to become a priest. He thinks, well, I should be able to go in and do whatever I want. I'm the king. No one's going to tell me no. So he gets the little censer to go burn incense, and he tries to force his way in. The priest's going to stop him. You're not going to do that. Yeah, I'm going to. No, we're going to stop you. And they were going to stop him physically. They were going to throw down with the king, except for what happened. God struck him with leprosy. And he was a leper the rest of his life, and he was cut off from Israel. So we have three people in Israel's history that were struck, not with blindness, not with deafness, not with lameness. They were struck with leprosy as a sign of their sin. So leprosy's significant in that sense as a sign of sin. Also, it was something that if you had leprosy, it would make you unclean. It wasn't that you were just sick. It was that you were unclean. In order to be reinstated back into the society, because if you had leprosy, they would quarantine you. They'd separate you. You couldn't be around people. You couldn't touch them. You'd have to be separated from the people. And in order to get you back in, it wasn't just, hey, the priest observes you 7 days, you know, the thing's gone. We watch you for 7 more days. It still hasn't come back. You're good. Just come on back. You're better, right? You don't just come back like that. There's a whole restoration process that's very significant. You need to be cleansed. You need to go through these Old Testament rituals. There's sacrifices that need to be offered. There's specific instructions about how they're to be offered. Blood is applied. It's very interesting, and we're going to spend some time in a moment talking about it. Leprosy would make a person unclean. They weren't just sick. They were unclean. Now, every one of us knows what it's like to be sick, right? You've walked into church sometimes sick, and you started to cough, and you didn't really want people to try to be incognito. Well, if you have leprosy, are you allowed to come to church? You can't go into the synagogue. If you go down the street and you have leprosy and someone sees you, what does the law say that you're supposed to do? You're supposed to shout out, unclean, unclean. You're supposed to give an announcement that the people will know so that they can stay away from you. There's a problem with me. Stay away. Not, I'm sick. I'm unclean. That's heavy. There were other things that could make you unclean as well. Leprosy wasn't the only one. Touching a dead body. A woman in her menstruation would be unclean. So there were several things that would cause a person to have an uncleanness. But leprosy was very significant. It was a sign of sin. It made a person unclean. It separated them from the community. And then in Leviticus chapter 5, verse 3, it says, if he touches human uncleanness, whatever the uncleanness with which a man may be defiled, and he's unaware of it, when he realizes it, he'll become guilty. That if someone touched a person who was unclean, even if they were unaware, they would become guilty themselves of an uncleanness. So there's a big stigma attached to leprosy. Now, when someone had leprosy, and it's interesting here that when the leper comes to Jesus, he bows before him. So remember, multitudes are around Jesus. He really couldn't go anywhere. This isn't a private meeting. This guy is coming into a big crowd. It's probably in a public place. And he comes before Jesus. And I would imagine the whole crowd, as the leper comes through, is like, what are you doing in the crowd? What are you here? Why? You're not even supposed to be here. I would imagine that as he probably started coming up, it's pretty obvious he's got leprosy. I would imagine he didn't have to push his way through the crowd. It probably just parted for him. Everybody's, whoa, what in the world's going on? And just magical parting of the sea, of the crowd of the people, as this guy makes his way up to Jesus, and then just falls at his feet and said, Lord, if you're willing, you can make me clean. And Jesus put out his hand and touched him and said, I'm willing, be cleansed. That Leviticus verse that talks about touching someone in their uncleanness would make you guilty. And here's Jesus identifying with a man's uncleanness to the point where he says, I'll touch you. I'll take your uncleanness. I'm the solution for all human uncleanness. My touch. I can take it away. And I'm willing to take it away. I came to take it away. This guy probably hadn't been touched by anybody who didn't have leprosy, you know, for however long he'd had leprosy. His parents, or maybe his wife, or his children, depending upon however old he was, or what his circumstances were when the leprosy came. Maybe he had been a leper for 20 years. He hadn't been touched by anybody who didn't have leprosy for 20 years. Nobody would touch this guy. He lived with other lepers in some kind of a leper colony. That's just the way that it was, and it still is in some places until recently. Jesus is the friend of the unclean. It's interesting that in the general statement about how Jesus went around teaching in the synagogues and then going around healing people, the first specific healing that Matthew wants to tell us about is when Jesus touched a leper. He said, man, you guys got to know that this happened. First one I'm going to tell you about. First story. Jesus touched this leper. This guy came in and said, if you're willing, you can make me clean. And Jesus said, I'm willing, you're clean, be cleansed. He touched him and healed him. It's interesting that the man didn't have any doubts about Jesus' ability. There had already probably been many other miracles. So his only question was, is Jesus willing? Because I know Jesus, you can. I know you can, but I don't know if you will. So if you're willing, make me clean. Jesus was willing. I've always just thought it's such a wonderful just simplicity out of the mouth of Jesus. In fact, in Greek, it's only two words. I'm willing is just one word, and be cleansed is just one word. Just the simplicity of it. If you're willing, you can make me clean. Willing, clean. I mean, we don't have our pronouns attached into our verbs like they do in Greek. So we can't, in English it sounds awkward, but the singular or plural or the first, second person, those are inside the verbs. So it's just two words out of his mouth. If you're willing, you can make me clean. I'm willing. Yes, I'm willing. I'm willing. Aren't you glad Jesus is willing to make unclean people clean? Not just a sick person well. Now, I don't know how you feel about your uncleanness. And I'm glad Jesus healed sick people, but I'm really glad that the leper got cleansed because I kind of feel like my problem and my need for healing is bigger than just someone who is really sick, or even like Lazarus' case, he was actually dead. Uncleanness has a bigger weight to me even than Lazarus who had died or the man born blind. This is a person that's cut off, that's in a place of a physical infirmity. There's a physical reality, but it has so much baggage attached to it and weight attached to it. And Jesus' answer to a person in that condition is, I'm willing. I'm willing to cleanse you. I want to cleanse you. If you're here and you're not sure if Jesus is willing to cleanse you, you have to know that he is. If this guy got this answer, then anybody else who would ever wonder if Jesus was willing to make them clean, they would never need to wonder. The answer's already been made clear by this guy's experience. And also for you personally, but for any person that you would ever meet, anybody that's in your life, we're in the holidays. We just had Thanksgiving. Many of us will be with family members again in the next couple weeks for the Christmas holiday. You might have some uncleanness in the family. You might have some people who have just crazy struggles, or they've messed up their life, or they've let stuff mar them, and they've got all this baggage and they're cut off. Well, just don't forget this guy and pray for them. Pray that God would help people come to their senses. Pray that God will draw people, because Jesus is always willing. He's always willing to make people clean. Now, people may not be willing like this guy to come to Jesus, but if someone comes to Jesus, they're not going to be turned away. He's going to clean them. He's willing. Be cleansed. And then immediately his leprosy was cleansed. Notice verse 4. This is really interesting what Jesus says to him. First thing in verse 4 is he says, see that you tell no one. Now, this would be a very difficult command to obey. I don't want you to tell anybody. Seriously. I just got cleansed from leprosy. I'm calling my mom. I'm calling my wife. I'm calling my kids. I'm calling my whoever. Like, what do you mean don't tell anybody? Well, this is very significant. Jesus has a serious agenda. He's not interested in having the most Twitter followers. He's not interested in having 80,000 likes on Facebook or this many friends or this kind of a... He's not interested in the superficial. He's interested in the real. Jesus is interested in real relationships with real people, and that doesn't happen in a circus, in a circus environment, and in a chaotic environment of hype. So Jesus, many times, when some of his most notable miracles happened, he raised Jairus' daughter from the dead and told the parents, don't tell anyone. He just dismissed the mourners who were mourning, the paid mourners that were there at the house, that were making all the ruckus, wailing because she had died. And then he raises her from the dead and then tells the parents, don't tell anyone. Just keep this a secret. Let's just keep this. Like, well, wait, I want to get my money back from the mourners. We hired them. And it's like, hey, she's alive. Come on, pay me back. I mean, how do you not say that? Well, Jesus was careful. He wasn't trying to draw attention to himself for the sensational. His teaching in the Sermon on the Mount would clear out the crowds. When he says, someone smacks you in the face, turn the other cheek. Well, I like the circus. I'm not sure I like the turn the other cheek teaching. Well, you can see that people could get the wrong idea about what Jesus was about. So it's interesting. Don't tell anyone. But I think it's even more significant. There's a priority. For this particular guy in this particular miracle, he says, go and show yourself to the priest. So there's something you need to do. Before you tell anybody, this is your priority. You go show yourself to the priest and offer the gift that Moses commanded as a testimony to them. So in the law, there's a whole chapter on what a leper is supposed to do if they were cleansed. What's interesting is you can read from Genesis all the way through Malachi, and with the exception of Miriam, her leprosy happens at the very beginning of the establishment of the law, but except for Miriam, you don't see any other lepers cleansed. Gehazi gets leprosy. Naaman the Syrian has leprosy, and he's cleansed, but he's not a Jewish person. So in the Bible, there's no account, not that it never happened, but there's no account in the scripture of a leper being cleansed. But there's a whole chapter on what a leper is supposed to do if they're cleansed. And it's very interesting. I want you to turn back there. Turn to Leviticus 14. This is that book you love to read through in your one-year Bible. I always get the questions like, these are a lot of sacrifices. There's a lot of detail here. Yeah, there is. In Leviticus chapter 14, it says, then the Lord spoke to Moses, verse 1, saying, this will be the law of the leper for the day of his cleansing. He'll be brought to the priest. So when you get cleansed from leprosy, you're supposed to go to the priest. So Jesus is right in line with what his law says. The priest will go out of the camp, and the priest will examine him, and indeed, if the leprosy is healed in the leper, then the priest will command to take for him who is to be cleansed two living and clean birds, cedar wood, scarlet, and hyssop. So the first part of this, there's two parts. The first part has to do with the first 7 days after the leper's cleansed, and it's involving two birds that are taken, and some cedar and scarlet and hyssop. Then the priest, verse 5, will command that one of the birds is killed in an earthen vessel over running water. And then the living bird, he'll take it and the cedar wood and the scarlet and the hyssop, and he'll dip them and the living bird in the blood of the bird that was killed over the running water. So when the leper is cleansed, in order for him to be reinstated, there's a sacrifice involved. This isn't just a sickness. This is something that has to be cleansed by a blood sacrifice. So the living bird is dipped in the blood. I'm sure the living bird does not enjoy this. He's dipped in the blood of the bird that was sacrificed. with these other things, the wood and the scarlet and the hyssop. And then, verse 7, he'll sprinkle it. The priest will sprinkle it 7 times on him who's been cleansed from the leprosy. And he'll pronounce him clean. And then he'll let the living bird loose in the open field. So the live bird is dipped in the blood with these other things. And then the leper, who's now clean, you're going to show he's clean by taking blood and going, whoosh, whoosh. And blood's going to be splashed on him from the bird and from the cedar wood and the hyssop and the scarlet. And then they take the bird out into the field and they let the bird fly away. Your leprosy, man, is gone. What an interesting ceremony. What's God signifying? Leprosy. It's, you know, if a person was blind and they were healed of their blindness, do they have to go through this? It's just very interesting. This animal has to be killed. And then, going on, verse 8, he who is to be cleansed will wash his clothes, shave off all his hair, and wash himself in water and that he may be clean. And then after that, he'll come into the camp and he'll stay outside his tent for 7 days. And then on the 7th day, he'll have a 7-day stubble. He'll look like Curly from the Three Stooges. At the 7th day, then he'll shave all the hair off his head and his beard and his eyebrows, all of his hair, he'll shave it off. And he'll wash his clothes and wash his body in water and he'll be clean. So there's the 7 days. That's not the end of this. And that seems like a lot. The guy's, his leprosy's gone. Well, now on the 8th day, verse 10, on the 8th day, he'll take 2 male lambs without blemish and 1 ewe lamb of the first year without blemish. 3 lambs. And 3/10 of an ephah of fine flour mixed with oil as a grain offering. And then it says 1 log of oil. Now that's a weird translation. It's a Hebrew word, the word that's translated as log. It's a Hebrew word that we don't know what it means. That word, it's a measurement, it's a quantity, and this word is only used in this chapter. So there's no other reference point to know what this is. And so I've never heard the English expression as a quantity, a log. Can I get a log of oil? And it's actually, I think it's an English word. They didn't know what to translate this, and there's an old French word that's L-A-G, a lag, or however, I know, it's like, you know, English, we just steal words and manipulate them and make them say, mean whatever. You know, English is a great language. So when you read this here, it says log of oil, and you say, what's a log of oil? No one knows what a log of oil is. It's a Hebrew word that means a quantity. So there's a certain specific quantity that they would have known. So fine flour, this quantity of oil, and 3 lambs. What do you think is going to happen to the lambs? When you read Leviticus and you read about a lamb, what's going to happen to the lamb? Okay? I don't want to give away the ending of the movie, but You don't want to try out for the lamb part for the Leviticus movie, okay? You know where that's going. Then verse 11. Then the priest who makes him clean, or the priest who makes clean, will present the man who is to be made clean and those things before the Lord at the door of the tabernacle of meeting. I thought he was already clean. 7 days, he's allowed to come in the camp, but he's not allowed to go into his tent at the 7th day. Then he shaves everything again, gets another wash. He washes all of his clothes. But the bird's already been released. The blood's already been sprinkled on him. But on the 8th day now, 3 lambs, or 3 of the 2 males and 1 female, and then oil and fine flour, and then this quantity of oil. And then he comes, and now he's going to be appearing before the Lord. Verse 12, then the priest will take 1 male lamb and offer it as a trespass offering, and the log of oil, and he'll wave them as a wave offering before the Lord. So these things are for the Lord, and they're waved. Then verse 13, then he'll kill the lamb in the place where he kills the sin offering and the burnt offering in a holy place. For as the sin offering is the priest, so is the trespass offering. It's most holy. Then the priest, this is where it gets very interesting. Then the priest will take some of the blood of the trespass offering, and the priest will put it on the tip of the right ear of him who's to be cleansed, and on the thumb of his right hand, and on the big toe of his right foot. Now, if you've never read the Old Testament, that just sounds weird on its own. He's going to take blood, and he puts it on his ear, and he puts it on his thumb, and he's like, okay, give me your big toe. And he puts blood on his big toe. Now, if you've read the Old Testament, that's immediately striking. Why? Because that only happens to one other person. There's another person in the law who has blood put on their ear and on their thumb and on their big toe. You know who it is? The priest. You consecrate the priest by taking the blood of the sacrifice, putting it on their ear and on their thumb and on their toe. But when you're cleansing a leper, you do the exact same thing. It's very interesting. Now watch as we go along here. Verse 15. Then the priest will take some of this log of oil and he'll pour it into the palm of his own left hand. And then the priest will dip his right finger in the oil that's in his left hand, and he'll sprinkle some of the oil with his finger seven times before the Lord. And then the rest of the oil in his hand, the priest will put some on the tip of the right ear of him who's to be cleansed, and on the thumb of his right hand, and on the big toe of his right foot, and on the blood of the trespass offering. So first the blood is put there, and then he's going to take the oil and sprinkle seven times before the Lord. Then he takes oil and puts oil in the same place where he put the blood. That didn't happen to the high priest. His consecration is different. And then, look at verse 18. Then the rest of the oil that's in the priest's hand, he'll put on the head of him who's to be cleansed. And the priest will make atonement for him before the Lord. So then the rest of the oil, he just pours on him. What's the word for pouring oil on somebody? Anointed. What's the Greek word for anointed? Christ. So who's anointed? Do they put oil on the priest? They don't put it on his ear and his thumb and his big toe, but they do anoint the priest with oil, and they anoint the priestly garments with oil. The priest is the anointed one. Well, guess who else in the law gets anointed in their cleansing? The leper. It's really fascinating. So the priest will make atonement for him. And then, verse 19, then the priest will offer the sin offering to make atonement for him who's to be cleansed from his uncleanness, and afterward he'll kill the burnt offering. So the three lambs are a trespass offering, a sin offering, and a burnt offering. And then also the grain is offered. Verse 20, the priest will offer the burnt offering and the grain offering on the altar, and the priest will make atonement for him, and he'll be clean. And then the rest of the chapter is if the person's poor and they can't afford three lambs. I would imagine not many lepers are going to have a lot of money since they're ostracized from society. So there's an alternative that's less expensive for somebody who wouldn't have the ability to bring in the lambs. Now, I wanted to take the time to go over this just so that you could see this interesting comparison. The priests in Leviticus chapter 8, when actually Moses puts into practice their cleansing, their consecration for their role as priests, that's when, in Leviticus 8, verse 23, that's when the blood's applied to their ear and their thumb and their big toe. And then here, the lepers have it. And also, Leviticus 8 earlier, when the oil is poured on the priest, that's Leviticus 8, 12, it's not applied to their ear and thumb and toe, but that's when they're anointed. And the lepers, part of the leper's consecration or his cleansing is being anointed with oil. But his is on his ear and on his thumb and on his toe and then poured onto his head. So it's interesting. If you just think about it, you almost have a visceral reaction. Today we were talking about this in the office and I was sharing with the guys. And Darren just kind of blurted out a reaction of, you know, if you're a priest, you know how you're anointed. The priests are unique. You could just say, who's the holiest person in Israel? Apart from Jesus Christ, at any time in Israel's history from the law, when Aaron's consecrated, till the Lord becomes the great high priest, who's the holiest person in Israel? I mean, he may not literally. I mean, Caiaphas is the high priest, so you could say, well, obviously. But just the priest. So who's the most unholy person in Israel? Who's the person most outside of the camp? Who's the person who's most unclean in Israel? The leper. So you're the priest, and the leper walks in, and you go, oh, he's cleansed. I think we got a chapter in here. So you get out the old law books. You're like, I learned about this in law school. There's something back in here. Let's get back in here. And then you'd read Leviticus 14. This dude gets consecrated the exact same way you got the priest office. You think God's trying to say something? I mean, we don't have any commentary from Jesus on why it's like this. There's no commentary in the passage on this. But there's sort of a reaction that you have the high priest or all the priests. They occupy this office. They're the holy ones. They're the ones that are standing in the presence of God on behalf of the people. And how are they consecrated or anointed for their ministry? Blood on their ear, on their thumb, on their big toe. Then the most derelict outsider in the whole nation walks in. Hey, I got cleansed from leprosy. And you get the exact same procedure, the exact same cleansing, and in the law of God. This isn't Jewish tradition. This is what Moses received from God. This is the law of God. This is the very word of God. I think God is signifying something here very interesting. Maybe the most honored person in the nation, the priest, and the most outcast person in the nation, and God sees them both exactly the same way. Isn't that awesome? Isn't that awesome? The Bible makes really clear God's no respecter of persons. This isn't the only thing in the Bible that makes us think God's no respecter of persons. Many, many things in the Bible. That's an emphasis in the Bible. Humanity, we all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Every single person is equal in the eyes of the Lord. And we all come to God in need of grace, every single one of us. I just think it had to have been interesting. We know in our passage that this guy, at least initially, didn't listen to Jesus. Mark and Luke also tell us the exact same stories, and in their telling, we get a detail. There's different details that they each emphasize, and I don't know if, I think it's Mark who says, this guy went around, he just told everybody. So he didn't really listen to Jesus. So if you don't listen to Jesus, you're kind of like this guy. Maybe he did end up down there, but if you can imagine what the significance is when the priest is anointing and thinking of his, like, you were consecrated for this office with blood on your ear and your thumb and your big toe, and this guy who's an outcast of society, and the exact same thing is being done for him. It's no difference. God has grace for all of us. And that's significant. I think it's not an accident that Matthew chose this. Mark also puts this miracle right at the beginning of his telling of the ministry in Galilee. And so the reputation of Jesus goes out in the land of what kind of people can approach Jesus. If you live in the Galilee and you're a drug addict, well, you're not a leper. You can come. I mean, maybe you're totally smoking some crazy weeds that they grow out in the fields or something, or maybe you're the guy that licks the frog and it's a hallucinogen, or you're the guy that eats the mushrooms, or you're the crazy guy that turns the sap out of the tree into an alcohol, or you're the violent criminal, or you're the robber. You know, do you hear what happened to Jesus? You hear what happened up in Capernaum? Man, there was this big crowd. There's this rabbi, and you know, he was down there with John the Baptist, I heard, but now he's back up here in the Galilee, and you're not going to believe what happened. What happened? A leper. What? Yeah, dude, a leper. There was thousands like this. There are hundreds of people, man. And all of a sudden, this person just barged, and everyone just got jumped out of the way, and he just came, and Jesus touched him. What? A rabbi touched a leper? Are you kidding? Do you think they could ever imagine in their mind? Think of the rabbis that they know. What do we know about the rabbis? Who does Jesus have all the conflict with? The rabbis. Do you think that anybody living in the Galilee would think ever, like, hell would freeze over before a rabbi would ever touch a person with leprosy? This rabbi, you're not going to believe what this guy Jesus did. This leper came up, and Jesus said, I'm willing, and he reached out and touched the dude, and that guy's leprosy was gone. Do you think that anybody after that would think that they couldn't approach Jesus? It kind of puts it into perspective. The woman with an issue of blood, what is she doing? She's pushing her way right through the crowd to touch Jesus. You think of a Gentile, one of the stories that we're going to get to right next, the very next story is the man, the centurion who helped build the synagogue there in Capernaum, has a servant who's sick, and he thinks that Jesus could help him. Why would he think that? I ain't a leper. And he helped a leper. If he helped that dude, he could help anybody. I think it's just really important for us to not lose the reality of who Jesus really is in his word. Not a Jesus who I wish him to be, not a Jesus that I kind of reconstruct in my mind, taking different elements from here and there that make a Jesus that's palatable to me. But the Jesus that we read about in the New Testament, he's very remarkable. He's challenging, he's uncompromising, he's strong, he's true, he never lies, he never holds back. He says things that get him killed. I mean, he's fearless. And yet, at the same time, a leper would come and Jesus would heal that guy by touching him. Now, you know, there you could get into an argument of like, well, if he touches him and he becomes unclean, how could Jesus become unclean? Who's the one who provides the cleansing and the atonement in Leviticus for the leper? The priest. The priest makes him clean. Who's Jesus? He's the great high priest. He's the priest after the order of Melchizedek. He's the one who came to bear our sins. Jesus will become sin for us who knew no sin. This is the identification of Jesus with sinful and lost man. In one microcosm of one event with one individual, you have this wonderful, amazing reality of who Jesus is. He'll touch lepers. Oh, you better believe he'll touch lepers. He's going to bear all the sins of the world. He's going to do more than touch lepers. He's going to take all the leprosy of all of humanity forever and let it all be poured upon him, on his holiness and his pure life. And as our great high priest, he's going to take his own blood, not a blood of a bird or a lamb, but his own blood, and he's going to make atonement for our sin. It's pretty awesome to think. It's just four verses. It's a quick little story. It doesn't take long to tell it. But I would imagine this story would have blown everybody's mind. And after this, you couldn't keep away any desperate person. All the people who just thought, no one will help me. Well, I'll go try Jesus. I mean, if that leper could go, anybody could go. We have to remember that. We have to remember that and look for lepers. Father, we pray that you would help us. We want this to be applied for our own lives, for our own selves, Lord. And if there's anybody who's here who especially feels their uncleanness acutely, they see in themselves the leper. They know that they're unclean. We just would pray, God, for all of us, that we would come to Jesus like this man did. We would come and we would let you cleanse us. And we thank you, Lord, we don't have to go through the rituals that were instituted by you in the law, because you're the fulfillment of all of those things. We can now just come to Jesus. We wouldn't have to, having been cleansed, go offer the sacrifice, Lord, because you're the sacrifice. You're the only way a leper could be cleansed. Your death on the cross and all those things were pointing to you. Those birds, that blood, that scarlet, that hyssop, that cedar, that log of oil, all of it, Lord, was pointing to you and what you would be able to do by yourself as you become our sacrifice. And so, Lord, in our own lives, may we just come to Jesus. Help us, Lord, to come to you with our uncleanness and let you cleanse us. And then, God, help us to reach out and give a touch to those people who maybe people don't want to touch them. Maybe they haven't been touched in a long time. A touch, a real true touch of love and hope and compassion. Lord, help us to love people. Open our hearts, Lord. Fill our hearts with your love. Bless your word, Lord. Encourage us. And especially as we get into this last bit before we join in the celebration of your birth on the 25th, that this next week and a half, Lord, as people are thinking about a change of mind and a season of giving, Lord, help us. Help us to truly show your love. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.